This is Access Houston on 97.9 The Box.
Good Sunday morning. You're listening to Access Houston. I'm your host, KG Smooth. Welcoming back. Well, he's really a friend to the show now. He's been on show multiple times, especially this year. So please welcome back Mr. Desmond Bertrand-Pitts, who is over there at the Buffalo Soldiers Museum running things.
Thanks for having me back.
Good morning, man.
Good to be a part of the family.
Yes, no doubt. And she is the Associate Director of AARP. Please welcome Shondra Wygal.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How
thank
are you?
Thank you for having us.
Oh, thank you for being here. You guys have teamed up to do something that's pretty incredible as the Buffalo Soldiers Museum presents M.I.A., Military Inspired Art Symposium, that is paying homage to our brave men and women of the armed services. This is great. Somebody needs to show them some love, because everybody else that claims to love them so much don't do it.
Yeah,
so how did this partnership come about between AARP and the Buffalo Soldiers Museum?
I think Shondra and Charlene reached out to me because you guys were looking for, you know, different things to do in the community. And then we kind of just brainstormed. We talked about an event that I was doing last year, which was MIA. So this will be the second year. So we talked about it and I bounced some ideas off of with Shondra. And it was too late for us to partner last year. Mm-hmm. But I said, you know, it's going to come back. And definitely after last year was over, the response was so huge. I was like, AARP has to be a part of this next year. So that's kind of happened. She just reached out and we said, hey, let's do something next year.
And so since this is the second year for MIA, what inspired you to want to do a military inspired art symposium?
So it was actually a dream. So I was trying to think of new programming. Since I've been at the museum in this position about 3 years now, I was trying to think of different things that we could do that's community oriented. Mm-hmm. So I was like, how can I merge what we're doing here at the museum? We're paying homage to the men and women who serve the country. Mm-hmm. How can we do that, but also merge arts and culture? Mm-hmm. I was in the museum walking around and I was looking at a lot of the paintings that we had. And what came to mind was that a lot of the paintings were from veteran artists. Mm-hmm. So why not create an event that's, you know, also military, but with art that was done by men and women who have served or who are still serving. So that's kind of how it was birthed. And then I was just thinking one day, I was like, you know, it's military inspired art. And that's how MIA came up. I was like, that's cool, because it kind of fits, you know, a play on the acronym, you know, right. Missing in Action.
Of course.
So it kind of fit. And from there, I just start putting pieces together, thinking of partners that could help me put it together. Because I never curated an exhibition before, but I knew this was something that was needed, and I didn't anticipate the response that it would get. Mm-hmm. And it's more than about just showcasing the art. Out of that event came so many discussions about PTSD and therapy and just stories of art and war. You know, how a lot of these artists, you know, the experiences that they had translates into the art that they create.
Yeah.
And you can actually see what they were thinking or what they were going through the art. So myself, I just had no idea what was happening and that it was going to be as big as it is. So,
well, hats off to you and applause. That is really dope. I think it's going to be très bien. So Shondra, when you all heard about what Desmond had did last year, and then he said you all reached out to him. What made you all want to reach out to him to be a part?
So first of all, let me give you a little bit of background about AARP and the work that we're doing.
Oh yeah, I was going to get there.
AARP is a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization with a social mission of really starting a conversation of talking to people and talking to them about how they want to age and how they want to age in place.
And what is the acronym for AARP? I mean, what does the acronym stand for? Right.
So
there?
We've retired the full name. We are now just the acronym.
Oh.
AARP.
Okay.
Yes. So, part of our mission is to to really work with people and their families, particularly veterans, their families, and really the military, and provide that support. And when Desmond told me that he was working on this, this fits perfectly into a program we call Operation Help Veterans. Mm-hmm. And basically the program is centered around three different pillars. The first one is caregiving. That is one of our biggest conversation starters for AARP, the financial security, and the fraud and Operation Protect Veterans. So basically the caregiving piece, when he told us about the PTSD panel that he wanted to do, along with, you know, providing the African dance and then the art that was included in it, the first thing that I thought about is that this is an event that people can actually bring their families. Yeah. So if a grandparent is keeping the grandkids on a weekend, they can stop by the Buffalo Soldiers National Museum and learn some history and see what actually, you know, talk to some actual military folks and even learn something while they're there. So this event was perfect for us, and we do appreciate all the work that Desmond has put in, and he is a great partner. He's made
and my
he,
team
and
my
your team,
so it's not just me.
Right. And they have made for great partners for us in the in an event like this. This is great.
This is exciting. For the second one, especially, I'm sure that I keep thinking about the art. And I haven't seen any of the pieces from the vets, but I can only imagine how amazing it must be, and how some pieces could easily go for $5,000, $10,000, $20,000 at an art auction. With the work that you saw with the first event last year, what were some of the things that struck you about what the vets were painting and how they were expressing what it was inside?
It was a little overwhelming. When we got to the panel discussion about their experiences and how it translates into art, just hearing the stories, like we had a World War II vet, Frank, I can't remember his last name, but he ended up donating a $5,000 painting to, and it's sitting in my office still to this day. And just his, the experience is kind of, it almost like you could feel it from him. Mm. Like he described World War II as very detrimental to his psyche, like his mental, like it damaged him in a, you know, a certain type of way, but art was how he relieved all of that stress, relieved all of that, all of the experiences on it. He was able to put it into something that the world could see. Mm-hmm. And I think that to me is like, it speaks volumes just to the experiences, to the men and women who serve, and for them to share a piece of that with the world. It's amazing.
Indeed. And Shondra, what are you all at AARP looking forward to on Saturday when we have the event?
Where our team of volunteers will be there. We will be serving as the folks that are going to be the greeters, so we'll be checking folks in.
Oh, okay. Cool. We also, liaisons of the, absolutely.
And we also have our state president, Charlene Hunter James, who will be on the panel talking about caregiving and some of the resources that AARP have. And if for anyone who's listening this morning, if you're a veteran and you want to know more about some of the resources that AARP has available, you can check us out at aarp.org and then do /veterans. Mm-hmm. And there are all kind of discounts, all kind of information that are available on that site for anyone who's a veteran, a member of a family who has a veteran in their family, they can access that as well.
Indeed. Nice. What is the age now to become a member of AARP? Because a lot of times when people associate AARP with old.
Oh, I'm getting old.
So our founder, Dr. Ethel Percy Andrews, had a saying that I like to use. What we do for all. While we focus on the 50 plus and we do a lot of our advocacy work on behalf of the 50 plus, we welcome folks of all ages. In fact, for some of our financial and financial security, we like starting those conversations as early as 35 and 40 because folks have time to kind of get their house in order to prepare for those days when they start thinking about retirement. So we don't, whenever people ask us about the age, we all kind of cringe. But if you just have to have an answer, it's 50 up. However, we do all sorts of events. We have free movies. We have all sorts of things that's open to just about anybody, to everyone. And if you want to know more about what we're doing here in Houston, visit us at aarp.org/Houston. Indeed. And you can see all of our events. And I can't think of maybe less than 1% of our events that we charge for. Most of them are free.
Indeed. Well, we love that. And, you know, open invitation to spread the word to Houston if you need, you know, that media outlet push. Desmond, where can people go to get more info on MIA?
So MIA, you can definitely get information on all of our social media, Facebook, Buffalo Soldier Museum, Instagram, BSNM Museum, our website, buffalosoldiermuseum.com. We also have, it's rather long, we also have registration for this Saturday for the event, and it's aarp.cvent.com/tx-7-27-buffalo. Or you can just call, it might be easier, 1-877-926-8300.
One more time.
So 1-877-926-8300 or aarp.cvent.com/tx-7-27-buffalo.
Indeed.
And you can also get it on our webpage, aarp.org/Houston, under the events tab.
Oh, that's a lot easier. And it's also free and open to the public.
Free and open to the public.
Yes. Oh, that was going to be my next question. So it is free. That's amazing. Well, big ups to you all doing it. Desmond, you have taken on quite the task because I know and I see what it takes to curate a museum with art, and it's very meticulous, even though it looks simple when you get there, but it's you have to pay attention to detail, and it's just a very meticulous job. So big ups to you.
It's a lot of moving pieces.
For that. Indeed. And Shondra, it is so nice to meet you. I hope you all come back on the program to let us know so we can let the community know about everything that you all are doing. That's why this show is here for that. So, you know, don't hesitate. So we appreciate it.
But thank you for having us this morning.
No doubt. Save the date, Saturday the 27th at the Buffalo Soldiers National Museum as they present MIA, Military Inspired Art Symposium, along with AARP. And curated by the man himself, the CEO of the Buffalo Soldiers National Museum, Desmond Bertrand-Pitts. So thank you all, Desmond and Shondra. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good Sunday morning. You're listening to Access Houston. I'm your host, KG Smooth. Welcoming back one of my absolute favorite people in H-Town. She is the president, playwright, and the founder of Houston Play on Purpose. Back, she's been on the show a lot this year. The lovely Holly Charles is back. Holly, how are you?
I'm good. How you doing?
Good. Let's talk. Last time you were here for, along with the great folks at Emancipation.
At Emancipation Park Conservancy,
and all thine getting for Juneteenth.
Incredible.
How was that on that level and with Joe's direction? How did you feel about everything?
Everything went really, really well. You know, the most beautiful part about being a playwright, you work really hard, but to see people's reaction when they walked out of the theater, people felt enlightened, and people felt not only enlightened but lighter when they walked out of the theater.
Lighter.
And again, we tell so much of the slave narrative, and that is totally appropriate to do that. So we know our history, but there's just not enough of what this beautiful Black legacy that we have, especially in Houston. And so I felt people walking out with their shoulders back, we're a very resilient people. Look at what we've done, this community that we created. Look, we come from greatness. That's I mean, that the gift I'm giving to my audiences ultimately becomes a gift to myself.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. We love that. And now you're back with another gift.
Yes, I'm back with another gift.
You are back with another
gift. Yes, Black, White, and Sunshine.
Black, White, and Sunshine. It's going to be running August 1st through the 4th.
Yes, yes.
And so I am very interested in this because you're tackling basically the school to prison pipeline.
As well as one size fits all policies for foster care. Ultimately, we're talking twofold. We are talking about systems. Yeah. And so back in October of 2018, we were trying to figure out, okay, let's be intentional. What do we want to, you know, what do we want to talk about this year? What do we want to discuss? What, you know, what's not being discussed? Who do we want to give a voice to? And so, I'm good friends with Marvin Pierre from 8 Million Stories. You know what he's doing.
Marvin.
Marvin's great. I mean, but Marvin's Marvin, right?
Yeah,
so he's changing the world. I don't know. He's somewhere holding the earth on the back of his shoulder because he's working. That man is working. And so he's been doing amazing things, disrupting the pipeline to prison. Mm. You know, he just says, absolutely no. Like, these kids that are already trapped in the system, we're not throwing them away. And so I'm looking at the work that he's doing. And then I also spoke with Matoya Ellis from Child Advocates of Fort Bend, who's also a good friend of mine. And so she was talking more about this lack of resources for not just children in foster care, but Black children in foster care and for the families. And we kind of forget about that. Like, we want to just service the children. But ultimately, if the best place for a child is with their parents, then we have to provide resources in order to make the family healthy again.
Right.
And we just never really address that. And so I'm listening to both of them. And I remember sitting across from them thinking, I'm not going to choose one over the other. Like, truly no child left behind, right? Like, I'm not choosing one cause over the other. And so this became about the racial disparities in both of these systems that keep our children trapped. This is about systems.
I don't even know where to go from here because that's been the story of every Black family or single Black mother or parent, you know, since they were... since these systems were put into place and implemented, you know, funny that we just having a conversation just last week, I said, you know, the kids in the cages doesn't surprise me about the government. I mean, this is the same government that have kept us Black folks suppressed for over 250 years. And even when they do give us a little something, i.e., you know, Section 8 housing.
Sure.
The single Black female with the kids, she can't even get the assistance if a man is living in that same house.
Well, you know how I feel about the disenfranchisement of the Black family unit, right? And so, obviously, even if it were not intentional, it's definitely not. The intention is not to keep us together. And so, my thing is from the very beginning. And so I think we have to really look at that. One thing that bothers me is reading all these statistics about recidivism, which a lot of people say, what is recidivism? That is the tendency to return to jail after being released. Right. And so retention rates and recidivism are really, really high for Black men. And we often look at that like, oh, well, that just means they just want to get in trouble. Like, you know, hey, they doing stupid things. And have we really looked at this system and the fact that, like, most of these young Black men have gone in, you know, they now have a record.
Mm-hmm.
They get out. They're on probation.
Mm-hmm.
Probation holds them to a higher standard than it does you.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You are.
And they're on there for years.
On there for years on years. And then you're sending them back to the same situation that they were in. They're not even supposed to be around felons, but you sent them back to the neighborhood where they came from. You've given them no resources.
Right.
In some cases with young children who go to jail, they have kind of adopted criminal activity from being inside. And maybe what they did was a mistake. And now they've, you know,
now they're institutionalized. It's an ongoing cycle.
So for people to resolve that, you know, Black men just out here making, you know what I'm saying? They just making mistakes, you know, and I'm not excluding everything. I'm saying
and
that
you don't totally subscribe to that.
No. What I'm saying is we have to look at systemic oppression. There is no way for us to talk about these numbers. And so I have said this multiple times, and in every interview that I do, I'm going to say that crime is not related to color or to race. Crime is related to poverty. Who is most likely to be impoverished? Mm-hmm. And so we have to deal with those issues, KG. We have to say, why is this happening? So even when we look at the foster care system, again, one thing that boggled my mind, I mean, really upset me, and it upsets me when I think about it even now, is that I was unaware that, first of all, Black children are twice as likely to be put into foster care. Mm-hmm. Like, they usually don't find a solution, right? A solution for the family. Or there isn't another family member in a situation where they can actually take the child.
No, they just throw them in there.
They throw them into those systems, right? Mm-hmm. And then the most eye-opening thing is that they only have a 50% chance of ever returning home. I had no idea that 50% of Black children who go into foster care never go home, but they're more likely to be in foster care. That already starts like this, you know, this downward spiral, this downward trajectory of life, when you've removed them from the people that they love, regardless of whether they are unhealthy or have different situations going on. We got to provide resources. And so what I'm saying is all of this still rolls into the same issue of systemic oppression and the types of people that this is happening to. This is not because they're Black. It's because they're poor. It's because they don't have resources. Right. And so I think that we've given up and we've just said, you know, these rates are high in one demographic or another, and we haven't taken the time or had the cultural sensitivity to ask ourselves why it's happening.
And if I could take it even a step further.
Please.
Some things that I found out that I was just absolutely floored about. Shout out to Jacqueline Alito from Real Beauty, Real Women. These kids also end up being sex and human trafficked. Through the foster care and adoptive system. And so
or even without being trafficked, molested, hurt, violated,
All of the above.
Yeah, there's so much that happens to these kids in these systems. And we have resolved to say, well, this is just the statistics. Stop talking about the numbers. Why aren't we talking about the kids?
The kids.
It clearly points to their situations beforehand, right?
Right.
So we understand that, and that's why we have lots of poor white people who are also in the same situation. The issue is that there's a disproportionate number of poor Black and brown people. So let's not pretend like we don't understand the issue. We're not providing resources. We're not providing anything for these children to thrive in their lives. We have just said, well, they're, you know, that's over. They're done. We're building, you know, prisons to support that instead of building strategy to support them.
You listen to Access Houston talking to Holly Charles, president, playwright, and founder of Houston Play on Purpose. Black, White, and Sunshine is running August 1st through the 4th. Where at?
Match Theater downtown. Yes.
Ooh,
Match Theater.
Back at the Match.
Yes, I love Match.
Ooh, wee. Very nice theater.
And it's a very intimate space. We're in Matchbox 2.
Yes, indeed. So get your tickets now. You can log on to HoustonPlayOnPurpose.com. One of the things that I loved with all of the productions that you've done, especially with the last one,
I'm Still a Woman.
You had a great panel discussion after that performance. Will the same be happening with this? Are you going to do that like one night?
Absolutely. So,
because this is
well, we've got to talk about this.
This is going to be.
Yeah, we have to talk about it.
Block out 4 hours of your day. It's going to be two for the play and two for the combo.
So one thing I want to be really clear about is that Houston Play on Purpose is, you know, I'm a writer and I love literature. I love fiction. I love words. And I hope that the audiences are entertained, but I pray that they are informed. And so those are two different things. And
edutainment.
Edutainment. Absolutely. And so, I was in education for 15 years. So that was my whole life, was tricking people into learning something.
Right.
And so that's what I do is a lot of times I like to spend a certain amount of time in research and then find a way to tell a fictional tale, but also give you factual information.
Yeah.
And so
that's what makes it so dope.
The important piece of this is that we got to have a talk back. Let's just be honest. I'm a creative. There's someone smarter than me, and I can't wait for you to come to this show and to figure out what resources you have in order to help combat this problem.
Come on.
So, I'm excited about being able to inform people again.
I'm excited about you being able to inform people again, too. So, please, Houston, show your love, because this woman puts in the work. And the work is incredible. I mean, when you see it, Houston Play on Purpose. The play is called Black White and Sunshine.
Yeah.
All right. So get your tickets now, running August the 1st through the 4th at the Match Theater. Log on to HoustonPlayOnPurpose.com. And you are changing the world. I've interviewed so many people on this program, and you know I purposely use this platform mm-hmm. for us.
Mm-hmm. There's that word again, purpose.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, indeed. Mm-hmm. And with the likes of you and Marvin Pierre, who we mentioned earlier, and
Metoyer Ellis over at Child Advocates. Yeah.
Derek Muhammad. Oh my God, Houston. Yeah, we have so many people who are about that life.
Yeah.
And want to see the change, you know, and the mm-hmm. better for us. Mm-hmm. And I just really give you all a standing ovation mm-hmm. for doing that. Mm-hmm. I want to do more. I wish I could do more. People say, well, KG, you are doing your part because you use your mm-hmm. platform. Like, this is huge. You know, mm-hmm. 97.9 The Box, legendary
yeah.
in Houston. You are, you know, doing your part. But I also still feel like I can be doing a whole lot more.
And can I celebrate some of the heroes who are already supporting this?
Yeah, go ahead.
Each night, almost each night, we have a different professional organization who's come in and said, not only that they're going to promote the show, but they're hosting the show. Mm. They're hosting the show. They're having receptions. They're bringing in, some game changers, influencers. They're having panels of experts. So when you go to HoustonPlayOnPurpose.com, you can choose which show you want to go. And depending on which show you go to, there'll be a reception as well as a panel of experts that goes with the show. So that's one ticket with three events into it.
All in one.
And so for our 2 p.m. show, She's Happy Hair, they have the She's Happy Foundation, and they have signed on, and they're creating a really very special panel.
Warren
so please
Marcus,
look up.
My yes, guys, those are in,
yeah,
those are
Warren,
two more.
Yeah, Warren Bridenecks, he's been amazing, and so he loves this project, and so he's putting his heart into it. And then on that same evening, we have National Black NBA Association.
Oh.
And so they are also hosting a reception and a show. And then 100 Black Men of Metropolitan Houston,
nice.
You know, yeah, they're putting their money where their mouth is. You know, they help, you know, young Black youth, and they've decided
to have.
So they have their reception, and they also have a talk back, a panel of experts that are coming right after
That's dope. So, yeah. You know.
So thank you, guys.
Yeah. Yeah, thank all of y'all. Y'all doing it.
Yeah.
And Houston, you get your tickets. Black, White, and Sunshine, August 1st through the 4th at Match Theater, a production by Houston Play on Purpose, the lovely Holly Charles. It's always a pleasure.
Always.
I cannot wait to
yes.
see this
yes.
and be a part of, or at least listen to the panel discussion after
yes.
The production. So, you know, open invite. Next one, let me know. You in this thing.
Thank you so much.
Man, I appreciate you. And thank you for listening to Access Houston.
We'll be back with more Access Houston on 97.9 The Box.